After knowing about characters and the virtues which are reported by Peterson and Seligman, let's know two more models about character strengths and how do we have certain type of strengths which can develop such kind of character strengths and virtues, which is our third model. So let's start with the second model, that's Gallup-Clifton Strengths Finders model, which is talking about talents. First, Clifton believed that talent could be operationalized. It means we can have operational definition of talents. These can be studied and accentuated work and academic settings. It means these talents have certain or very particular role and very important role in working and academic settings. So he has highlighted such kind of talents. First of all, he defined talent. Naturally reoccurring patterns of thought, feeling or behavior that can be productively applied. This is the talent's definition. So it means when we have particular talents, these are reflect in our thoughts, in our feelings, in our behavior, and these are can be applied in productive manner. He also stated that life experiences characterized by desiring, rapid learning, satisfaction and timelessness. So these talents are persistent in our behavior and these are actually giving direction to our satisfaction. Because of these talents, we have rapid learning and we desire such kind of talents in our personality. He considered that these talents like raw materials. Raw material means these talents are available at the time of birth, and to be the product of normal healthy development and successful childhood and adolescence experiences. He also stated that these talents will be flourishing if we are getting good environment, facilitating environment. So again, like psychoanalytic perspective, he has focused on childhood and adolescence flourishing experiences. So broadly, talents is result of heredity and environmental factors as well as their interaction. So if we have good raw material as well as flourishing environment, then we would be having better talents as compared to if we don't have good raw material as well as our environmental conditions were not that good and we had languishing, you know, environmental conditions which were not supporting development of our talents. He also stated that strengths as extension of talent. More precisely, the strength construct combines talent with associate knowledge and skills. So he said strengths are combination of our talent as well as knowledge and skills. He also stated that ability to provide consistent near perfect performance in a specific task. If we have such kind of talents which are combination of knowledge as well as you know, skills, and that's why we have particular type of strengths, these strengths are consistent in our behavior as well as we have peak performances, best performances if we have such kind of strengths. After that, he talked about success, how success and such kind of strengths are correlated with each other. He said success to be closely allied or associated with personal talents, strengths and analytic intelligence. So for success, we need personal talents, strengths and analytic intelligence. These are highly correlated with success. So first of all, he identified more than 100 personal talents which are predicting success in work and academics. Then again after a certain period, he reviewed the data in conducted researches and identified 34 themes of talents involving enduring positive personality qualities. So out of these hundreds, he identified 34 main themes of talent and he counted them positive personal qualities. On the basis of these researches, he developed assessment tool, and this assessment tool is available in 17 languages and it is appropriate for administering to adolescent and adults with reading level at 10th grade or higher. So 10th pass person can administer such kind of you know, assessment tools, and these are available for adolescents as well as for adults and now translated in 17 languages. So what are those 34 themes? As per Clifton Strengths Finders, he identified these 34 strengths or themes as strengths which are highly connected with success. These 34 themes are achievers, activators, adaptability, analytic, arranger, belief, command, communication, competition, connectedness, consistency, context, deliberative, developer, discipline, empathy, focus, futuristic, harmony, ideation, includer, individualization, input, intellection, learner, maximizer, positivity, relator, responsibility, restorative, self-assurance, significance, strategy, and woe. Out of all these 34, finally in 2005, he identified 10 best themes or 10 best strength finders themes. These 10 are achieving, caring, competing, confidence, dependability, discoverer, future, thinker, organizing, presence, and relating. After that, he defined all these 10 strengths and he said achieving means you have more energy and more goals than other people. You love a sense of accomplishment. It means you have more energy and more goals as compared to others if you have this strength, and your level on achieving is higher as compared to other people. Second strength, he said caring. Caring means in your heart, helping other people is very important. You want to make the world better by helping people in small ways or bigger ways. So caring means you care others, and your score is higher as compared to other people on caring. Third one is competing. You see many things in life as a game, and you feel great joy when you win. You truly hate to lose because you are always striving for first place. It means competing is your main strength, and you want to compete in each and every situation, and you play to win and strive for first place. You hate to lose. So these are your qualities. That's why you have high score on this strength, and that is your strength. Next one is discoverer. A thinker and learner. You are excited about exploring ideas and making connections. You like to ask the questions how and why. So discoverer person means the person who is asking number of questions, what, how and why, and trying to identify various aspects of the thing and discovering new ideas, discovering new facts, and that is your strength. Next strength is future thinker. If you have these characteristics, then that is your high score as well as you have that strength. Your mind loves to think and dream about the future. You are a person who thinks about what is possible, not what is impossible. So future thinker means future planners and think about future things, what you can do, dreams about futures are the main characteristics of the such kind of strength. Next one is the organizer. Organizer means scheduling, planning, and organizing your world makes life better. People count on you to get the details right and pull a plan together. So if you have such kind of strength, then you have better scheduling style, better planning style, better organizing style, and you can plan any event better than others. Next strength is confidence. It means you believe in yourself and what you can do. This helps you to take on challenges because you feel sure you can succeed. So your confidence level is higher as compared to others, and that is your strength. Next strength is dependability. It means trustworthiness. Agreeableness is highly connected with such kind of strength. Trust is important to you, and you care about being seen as responsible and trustworthy. People count on you to do what you say you will do. So people can easily depend on your work as well as on your plans because they trust you, and that is your strength. Next is presence. You were born to be at the front of room, telling stories and taking the lead. Other people watch you and listen to you. So your presence is better as compared to others, and people want to watch as well as want to listen you. That is your strength. And the last one, relating. It means you like to start friendships and keep them for a long time, maybe even your whole life. You widen the cycle of friends for yourself and others. So you believe in relationship. You are developing number of relationship and long lasting relationships you have. That is your strength. So finally, he has identified these 10 strengths. And on the basis of these 10 strengths, he identified 4 main areas like executing, influencing, relationship building, and strategic thinking. It means if you have executing strengths, then you have high score on achieving, dependability, and organizers. On the other hand, if you have influencing strengths, then you have high score on competing, confidence, and presence. On the other hand, if you have relationship building strength, then caring and relating high score you must have. On the other hand, strategic thinking, it means discoverer and future thinker you are, and you have high score on these two. That's why strategic thinking is your strength. So like that, by counting these 10 strengths, he has proposed his model. Another model is the Search Institute's 40 development assets. In this model, this institute has identified 40 developmental assets. The Search Institute's 40 development assets are considered common sense, positive experiences and qualities, and are identified as reflecting primary contributors to the thriving of young people. So in this model, they have identified 40 developmental assets which are required during developmental stages. And if you have these 40 assets, then you have a higher level of thriving, or quality of life, or can say psychological well-being, because of these 40 developmental assets. So when we are saying developmental assets, it means during young people, during your developmental stages, you had these 40 assets, and that's why you are qualifying having higher level of psychological well-being. The developmental assets framework categorizes assets according to external and internal group of 20 assets each. So finally, they have identified 20 external assets and 20 internal assets. 20 external assets are the positive experiences that children and youth gain through interaction with people and institutions. It means whenever you interact with your surrounded environment, whenever you meet other people, then there are these assets available which are making your situation thriving, and that's why you have better quality of life. And another section is 20 internal assets. These assets are the personal characteristics and behaviors that stimulate the positive development of young people. So these are the characteristics, we can say qualities in our behavior, or can say traits in our behavior or in our personality, which are facilitating thriving state of mind. And that's why we have higher level of well-being. So let's know what these 20 internal as well as 20 external assets. When we talk about external assets, these assets are, first is the support, then family support, positive family communication, other adult relations, caring neighborhood, caring school climate, parents' involvement in schooling. These are the part of the support. So let's take one by one. Family support means family life provide high level of love and support. So if you are living the environment where you are getting love and support, that is your family support. Positive family communication is the next one. Young person and her or his parents communicating positively, and young person is willing to seek advice and counsel from parents. So if you are getting, as a young person, if you are getting advice as well as counseling whenever it's required, then that is positive family communications, and you have good communication with your family members, which is supporting as an external asset. Next one is other adult relationship. your healthy and happy relationship with other people who are really important in your life. Young person receives support from three or more non-parent adults, whoever are important in your life. The next one is caring neighborhood. Young person experiencing caring neighbors. Caring neighbors means whoever is in your surrounding, they are caring, they are helping you, they have happy and healthy relationship with you. Next is caring school environment. School provides a caring and encouraging environment that is also required for healthy growth. Next one is parents' involvement in schooling. Parents are actively involved in helping young person succeed in school. So that is also important. So it means if you just see you and your surrounded environment as well as important social agents helping you to grow, that is required and counted as external assets. Second one is the empowerment. You know, during this period, we learn autonomy, we learn several things. Do we get that facilitating environment? That is very important to identify. So, community values youth. That is first characteristic. Young person perceive that adults in the community value youth. So, are you getting valuable work? Are you getting valuable relationship? That is important as a community support here. Youth has resources. Do they use youths as resource? Young people are given useful roles in the community because during playing these roles, you are learning various things. Are you getting that kind of environment that is supporting your growth? Next one is the service to others. Young persons serve in the community 1 hour or more per week. So during service, you interact with the people, you learn various new things. And next is the safety, which is very important here. Young person feels safe at home, at school, and in the neighborhood that facilitate to our positive growth. Next factor is boundaries and expectations. You know what are your boundaries as well as expectations, and this is the period where you are learning all those things. Family boundaries. Family has clear rules and consequences and monitors the young person's whereabouts. So, are you able to get such kind of environments, and you know clarity in rules and consequences, what is supposed to do, what is not supposed to do? Are you getting clear-cut indications? Next is school boundaries. What kind of expectations schools have? So, school provides clear rules and consequences so that you can learn what kind of behavior is expected here, what kind of behavior is not expected at all. So, as well as if you are doing such kind of behavior, what kind of consequences you could have. So, clarity in all these matters so that you can learn appropriate behavior. Next one is neighborhood boundaries. Neighbors take responsibility for monitoring young people's behavior. So, that is again very important. Adult role models. Parents and other adult models positive responsible behavior. So, do they have such kind of behavior so that you can learn better behavior? Positive peer influence. Young person's best friends model responsible behavior. So, do you have good peer influence, or it's facilitating your behavior in right direction? So, that is very important. Next is high expectations. Both parents and teachers encourage the young person to do well, and they are supporting such kind of environment. These are the assets in young person's development. Next is constructive use of time, because this is the time to learn new things. This is the time to memorize new things. That's why constructive use of time is very important. So, when we say, you know, various part of it, first is creative activities. Creative activities means young person spend 3 or more hours per week in lessons or practice in music, theater or other arts. So, somewhere creative task this person is doing, as well as he is getting such kind of facilitating environment, that is very important for this person. Next is youth programs. Young person spends 3 or more hours per week in sports, clubs or organizations at school and in community organizations. So, certain platforms where they are having some programs related to sports, related to clubs, related to organization, so that you can learn certain programs which are really important for a youth. Next is religious community. So, young person spends 1 hour or more per week in activities in a religious institution. That is also required here and part of this model. Next is time at home. Young person is out with the friends with nothing special to do, two or fewer nights per week. So, he has to balance time with the family, friends, as well as some time, entertainment, or where this person is free from all other stresses. So, such kind of activities or time at home as well as with friends should be balanced one. That is again another external assets. So, like that, he identified those 20 assets which facilitate a person's or a youth's progress in positive direction. Along with these external factors, he also discussed 20 internal assets. Internal assets means these are your qualities, these are your traits, these are your positive personality traits which are facilitating quality of life or thriving in your life. What these 20 internal assets are? First is commitment to learning. That is very important. Again, it's in terms of internal assets has been highlighted, because this is the period where you are learning, memorizing various things which will be important in your life. So, achievement motivation is the first one. Young person is motivated to do well in school, and that is required at this stage. Next is school engagement. You know, this schooling is topmost at this age. That's why they have identified that young person is actively engaged in learning in the school. Homework, young person reports doing at least 1 hour of homework every school day. So, must do homework, because that's the part of learning. Next is bonding to school. Young person cares about her or his school. That is next one. Reading for pleasure. Young person reads for pleasure 3 or more hours per week. That is required. And these all are the part of learning. And through those, activities, one person shows commitment to learning. Next one is the positive values. This is the period where you are developing your values. So, what are the ways to develop them? First one is the caring. Young persons place high values on helping other people. So, you learn to care others, and this should be promoted in any given community, society, school, or such kind of group behavior. Next is equality and social justice. It means young persons place high value on promoting equality and reducing hunger and poverty. So, you learn to have equality and social justice. Next one is integrity. Integrity means young person acts on convictions and stand up for his or her beliefs. So, integrity is required in or the development of integrity at this stage. Next one is the honesty. Honesty, young person tells the truth even when it is not easy. So, learn to speak truth at this stage. Next one is responsibility. Young person accept and takes personal responsibility. So, you learn to take responsibility at this stage. Next one is the restraint. Young person believe it is important not to be sexually active or to use alcohol or other drugs. So, this is the period where you learn what you are supposed to do, what is not allowed, what is not allowed at all, and you know consequences of such kind of things like drug addictions, and you learn to restrain from such kind of things. Next one is social competencies. Social competencies means young person learns planning and decision making, know how to plan ahead and make choices. So, he learned to make choices as well as plan his activities in school as well as maybe when he is working in the community. Next internal asset is interpersonal competence. Interpersonal competence means young person has empathy, sensitivity and friendship skills. Culture competency. Young person has knowledge of and comfort with people of different culture, racial, ethnic backgrounds. So, you learn there are various cultures, various races, ethnic groups are there, and accommodate in each and every one. resistance skills. Young person can resist negative peer pressure and dangerous situations. So he knows, and that's the part where he is learning what is right and what is wrong. So he should be capable to resist negative peer pressure. Or if a situation is dangerous, he should avoid such kind of situation and learn to avoid them. That is very important at this stage. Peaceful conflict resolutions. Young person seeks to resolve conflict non-violently. He must learn such kind of skills also. Next one is the positive identity. When we are talking about positive identity as an internal asset, then personal power, self-esteem, sense of purpose, positive view of personal futures are important. So, personal power. Personal power means young person feels he or she has control over things that happen to me. So, he or she knows what is required, what is not required, and accordingly able to plan the situation. So, that is this person's personal power. Next is self-esteem. Young person reports heavy high self-esteem. Self-esteem is very important, and again if we have positive environment as well as internal strengths, then only we can have high level of self-esteem. Next is sense of purpose. Young person report that my life has a purpose. Again, very important. In happiness chapter, you will find that is main factor to define happiness, purpose or meaning in life. And this is the period where he is learning whether he has meaning as well as purpose in his or her life or not. Next is positive view of personal future. Young person is optimist about her or his personal future. So, he must be optimist. He must learn to be an optimist person, because optimism is again contributing positively to our health, our quality of life as well as well-being. So, like that, they have identified these strengths. And if we have these internal as well as external assets, then only we can develop certain strengths which are contributing to our quality of life, contributing to our well-being, contributing to our growth in our life. And this model focusing on the internal as well as external environmental factors in terms of assets, in terms of possessions, in terms of resources which are helping us to have better lifestyle. After knowing all these three models, let's know culture and language issues in diversity of traits. That's again very important, because I think now you can easily identify some of these character strengths may be universal, but others culture specific. When we are talking about culture and language issues in diversity of traits, I think first of all we must know what culture is. A culture in the sense that people have a shared set of beliefs, norms and values. So, in the particular culture, we may have particular type of behavior, and because it's contributed by a culture, so most of these people staying in this culture may have similar kind of behavior. Culture counts, culturally relevant strengths we have. It has been observed that we have some specific strengths, character strengths or virtues as per particular culture, and considering culture in practice is very important for us. So, when we talk about culture or divide strengths on the basis of culture, then we can say cultural variation is there, and in as per this variation there could be two types of character strengths. One, universal character strengths, and second, culture specific strengths. Universal strengths in any culture, in any society or nation, these are available and we can count them universal strengths. On the other hand, it has been observed that there are some strengths which are actually culture specific strengths. If you just review past classes where I discussed 24 character strengths as per Peterson and Seligman's model, as well as I discussed with you the study which we conducted here in India, if you could recall the study which I discussed in the last classes where we identified how college students are defining character strengths, and we collected data from rural area, from small town Rohtak, from big city Chandigarh, and then from metro city Delhi. and observed that there were some culture specific strengths. I think you can easily identify these strengths were not reflection of those 24 characteristics which we discussed in Peterson and Seligman's model. We had some specific strengths also. So those kind of strengths can be counted culture specific strengths. On the other hand, in this research paper, we also documented that rural and urban college students have different focus on character strengths, and they have highlighted different character strengths. So we connected it with individualistic as well as collectivistic style. So that way we can say culture variation is there. And when we identify character strengths, we count both things, universal strengths or character strengths as well as culture specific strengths, and we give due weightage to a culture when we are talking about character strengths. Each of these facets may have different meaning, relevance, salience in the lives of unique individuals, and all may affect what is decided to be a positive behavior or trait within a particular culture and context. So culture wise, we may have different definitions or different way or to identify them. We must open our minds in term of understanding that healthy functioning or positive trait are subjective phrases influenced heavily by cultural worldview. So that's why what are the definitions of healthy functioning or positive traits? These could be culture specific responses. For example, in individualistic cultures, the main focus is on the single person who is held above the group in terms of importance. Competition and personal achievement are emphasized within these cultures. And broadly, if we talk about individualistic versus collectivistic cultures, we can easily identify that in individualistic cultures, we find more I-oriented responses. On the other hand, in collectivistic cultures, we usually find we-oriented responses. So, message from this discussion is culture sensitive recommendation should be there when we are talking about research, practice and policy making. We should count culture, and there could be culture sensitive recommendations which we must highlight. On the other hand, there are some studies by using multicultural personality questionnaire as well as multicultural mindset as a strength. Multicultural personality questionnaire means it includes 5 factors which are describing personality style which is more comfortable for moving in other cultures, like cultural empathy, open-mindedness, emotional stability, initiative, flexibility. So if you have high score on these factors, then you have multicultural personality style. Similarly, multicultural mindset as a strength. Some of us are quite rigid, and when we move from one culture to another one, we have more adjustment issues, problems. On the other hand, some other people are quite comfortable. They can easily move and change in new culture and can adapt new culture easily. So if you have such kind of mindset, then you have multicultural mindset. Multicultural mindset has been counted as a strength. It means a willingness to adapt to new ideas and to learn about new cultures, predicting his or her ability to conceptualize, link different ideas. So whenever you are moving or going in new cultures, you are able to adapt them. You can learn new ideas, new way of living, and happily you accept new cultures things. So such kind of mindset is counted multicultural mindset, and that's opposite to closed mindset, where you may have problem to adjust in new problems. So this is based on the qualitative data and qualitative studies to understand character strengths and virtues. What happened when we take psychological test? You know, most of the time we use psychological test to assess character strengths and virtues as well as other personality traits. It has been observed that when we have such kind of psychological tests which are developed in Western cultures, when we adapt and when we reconfirm or revalidate in other cultures, again culture plays very important role. Let's discuss it with this example. You must be knowing that Value in Action Inventory of Strengths is a assessment tool which is studying or which is assessing these 24 character strengths and 6 virtues. This inventory is developed by Peterson and Seligman, and in this inventory there are 240 items. These 240 items are having 24 character strengths questions, and each character strength has 10 questions. So, like that, there are 24 character strengths multiplied by 10, and total 240 items we have in this scale. These 6 virtues also available there. So, it is assessing these 6 virtues also, because we know out of these 24 character strengths, which character strengths are come under particular virtue. Now, when we are saying 6 virtues and 24 character strengths, as I discussed in the last classes, this is the theoretical model. This theoretical model means it is not statistically proven model. So, now what happened when we tested it again and again in different cultures, this model which has 24 character strengths and under 6 virtues. So, once again I am repeating this point, there are 6 virtues as you know, and under these 6 virtues there are 24 character strengths. Theoretically they explained this model as well as they proposed psychological test, they means Peterson and Seligman. Now, after proposing this model which we have discussed in the last classes, it has been statistically tested in different culture. When it was tested in different cultures, it has been observed that it is not showing same results. Same results means which is their theoretical model in which they have 6 virtues and 24 character strengths under these 6 virtues. And I think easily you can recall which these 6 virtues were as well as 24 character strengths. Now, culture's role. Different factor solutions were found for the different populations, ranging from a one factor solution found in the Indian adaptation of Hindi version of this scale. It's very interesting because these both studies were conducted by us, and these studies which were conducted by us are documented in this book, Positive Psychology, the Scientific and Practical Exploration of Human Strength. And very interesting these studies are. You would like to know about them more because these studies are from India. I think this point is clear to you. The real model is 6 virtues. Under these 6 virtues, we have 24 character strengths, and this is theoretically well explained model. Now, when we tested statistically, what happened over there? Different factor solutions were found for the different populations, ranging from a one factor solution found in the Indian adaptation of Hindi version of this scale, Value in Action Inventory of Strengths. So, in this study, we observed that when we translated this scale in Hindi and collected data and statistically analyzed the data, we found that all those virtues were come under one category, and we had one master virtue. The various virtues could not be distinguished from one another statistically, and we observed and documented one master virtue in this study. On the other hand, when we collected data on English version, on the original version, then we observed there was 5 factor structure, which was to some extent matching with the existing other researches where they conducted statistical analysis. So, it means studies showing that this model, which is theoretically explained model, it has different results in different cultures. For example, this data was collected from the same country, but in Hindi as well as in English. English we observed 5 factor structure, on the other hand in Hindi we observed one factor solution and we called it master virtue. Similar kind of study supported for one factor solution as well as 5 factor structures we documented along with our results. So, these results, different factor solutions were supported by various other researches which were existing in literature, and that's why we are saying that culture is very important. So, on the basis of these studies, research findings suggest that culture may play a substantial role in the preferential treatment expression and uses of the character strengths. So, lesson from this discussion is whether we are collecting qualitative data, whether we are collecting quantitative data by using psychological test, culture may play significant role, and we must count culture when we are talking about character strengths and virtues. And when we are using first time new psychological test in new culture, first of all, statistically we should analyze how this psychological test is playing role in this given culture. And for this purpose, we do revalidation of these skills in the given culture before relying on their results. So, restudying reliability and validity of the scale in the given culture is very important before documenting results based on that psychological test. That is very important for us. This chapter is over. And you know, in starting you had various questions. Let's revisit those questions and answer these questions once again, and then compare your questions with the first class answers and see what are the changes in your responses. So, again the same questions: identify your best 5 character strengths. Do you have better way to identify your best 5 character strengths? Second one, which are your ideal character strengths? Third was, which character strengths would you like to see in other people, in your society or in your culture? Next was, do you think these strengths enable us to have a higher level of happiness? I think now you have better responses. How do we assess character strengths? I think now you know there are 2 ways broadly. Sometimes we ask open-ended questions, sometimes we use psychological test. Do we have cultural differences in character strengths? I think easily you can answer this question now. This chapter is over. I would like to show this YouTube video, Cloud Film, on the science of character strengths. Enjoy this video. Thank you very much.
There are 7 billion, well actually 7.1 billion humans on the planet. And each one of us has a unique character.
So what determines your character?
You do.
And all the people around you.
And of course some genetics too.
But there's new science proving that if you focus on certain parts of who you are, you can develop your character.
And ultimately live a more meaningful, successful, and happy life, no matter what your circumstances. I mean, isn't that what we're all trying to figure out?
Oh, what?
This whole idea about developing our character really took shape in 2004, when 2 psychologists suggested that instead of just focusing on all the things that can go wrong with us, it's also important to celebrate all the things that can go right. You see, they looked throughout history to identify core virtues that humans across cultures have agreed lead to a meaningful life. And then they identified 24 character strengths that, when practiced and developed, could lead to these virtues. And they organized them, like scientists have done throughout history to understand things better. These groundbreaking studies showed that every person is a unique combination of these strengths. Like for me, I'm high on curiosity, I could work a little on the prudence. Actually, what is prudence? Anyhow, one of the most interesting parts of all this is they found that if we focus on building upon the strengths we have, it has a lasting effect on our happiness and well-being.
So think about it. What are your top 5 strengths?
Now, another part of this is that you can help shape other people's character too. They found that the key to human relationships is ultimately appreciating the character strengths in others. To explore this, we asked people around the world, who do you admire and why?
I admire my mother the most because she's very loving and caring. Все счастье целеустремленными людьми, которые готовы
бороться за свою цель. The person I admire the most is Einstein, of course.
My sister, because she is so tough and so brave.
People who use their creative energy to make the world a better place.
This powerful new framework paved the way
for a whole new era of social science that, it turns out, is unpacking a very old idea. So how do we develop these character strengths? One theory suggests that people either have a fixed mindset or a growth mindset. A fixed mindset is the belief that we're born with certain abilities, intelligence, and talents, and we're stuck with it. A growth mindset is believing I can change. If I set my mind to it, I can do anything. Let's take, for example, failing at something. With a fixed mindset, failing means I'm a failure. A growth mindset understands failure happens to everyone. Of course, it's hard. I've been there. But it's also something to learn from, something to improve upon. Fortunately, we can all develop a growth mindset. It takes practice and it takes encouragement from the people around us, but it can be learned. And it's all because of an amazing part of the human brain called the prefrontal cortex. It's like our brain's control panel that orchestrates our thoughts and actions. What many scientists call executive functions. Or what neuroscientist Adele Diamond calls self-regulations. I like to think of it as my self-control filter, the thing that keeps my impulses and emotions in check. And the way to strengthen that filter is as simple as taking a moment, focusing your attention, and asking yourself, is what I'm about to do a reflection of who I am and who I want to be? So while we're all becoming more and more distracted in this age of distraction, we need to remember to take a moment and think. There are a lot of new exciting conversations happening about character. One that I find interesting is that there are 7 strengths in particular that can be real game changers in academic achievement, success, and happiness, no matter what your circumstances. Those 7 are optimism, gratitude, social intelligence, curiosity, self-control, enthusiasm, and perseverance, also known as grit. While there have been many different theories about character throughout history, what scientists in this field agree on is that character matters, and that character strengths can be learned, practiced, and cultivated. So when you think about yourself, what are your strengths? And how can you find ways to use them more in your home, work, school, and community? It's like you have these superpowers, and focusing your attention on them makes them stronger. And then, if you focus on the people around you and their strengths, it makes them stronger too. As each of us becomes our best versions of ourselves and encourages others to do the same, we can lead to important changes throughout the world. Just imagine a world infused with more humanity, justice, courage, wisdom, and compassion. So if you can be a better version of yourself, how do you want to be?
I definitely want to be somebody that other people can feel they can rely on.
A man who was courageous.
Somebody who went for their goals.
A risk taker.
Kind.
Exactly like my mom. Beautiful, strong, and powerful.
I want people to say that I'm funny.
Who is a nice person?
Música.
Generous.
Be yourself.
Kind.
Accountable.
Incondicional.
I'm a new child, but I'm awesome.
También sensible. Profesional.
Charismatic.
I want to become someone who, when the time comes for me to die, I go, oh my goodness, I have used it up. I have wrung it dry.
Everybody is a star. They just need to learn how to shine.